How many people have had a chance to see some of Frontline's content tonight? Awesome. How many people have done VR for the first time tonight? Anybody? Wow. This many people have already done VR. Right on. You are now like the most VR like knowledgeable people in probably all of Boston. Brookline. So I'm Kathy Bisbee. I'm the executive director here at Brookline Interactive Group. Welcome to our space. What do you guys think? Pretty cool?
Yes.
Pretty cool space. We are a community media arts center here in Brookline. We serve just Brookline, but we also serve beyond through various initiatives. And I'm here with Al Williams.
Hello.
From Northampton Community Television. He's the executive director there. Do you want to say a word or two about what you guys do?
We're a community media center, very much like Brookline Interactive Group. Really, our goal is to empower expression across all forms of media. So that's why we were interested in the VR space as it's been developing.
And together, Northampton and Brookline, we started going to a lot of conferences the last year or so, really. Since last October, we went to the Future Storytelling Conference in New York City, and I was kind of not that into VR, honestly. And I got there, and I got to see the Syrian refugee camp story, and took the goggles off and was crying. And it was really impactful for me. I'm a documentary filmmaker previously, and to feel it so viscerally, to have an experience with other human beings that weren't actually in front of me was really impactful for me. And in fact, I stayed in the VR tent, and what happened, Al?
Kathy blew off Al Gore to play video games.
This has to be recorded in history because...
it wasn't intentional, but it was still very, very fun to see.
I was not into video games, in fact. Kind of hated them. And so it's kind of funny. I'm very political, and so the fact that I blew off Al Gore is sort of tells you a little bit of how the impact on me was in that moment. It was pretty powerful. I really saw the possibility of empathy, which is one of kind of my favorite things on the planet. I think we could change a lot of things in the world if we had a lot more empathy and compassion and understanding for each other. And so I saw that potential, as many of you probably have in VR, and I was really just blown over by it. And I really also saw it as an extension, virtual reality and AR and 360 video, as an extension of the work we do in public access community media. And how many of you have been in a town where there's a community cable channel? Okay. How many of you run community cable channels or work at one? A couple of you? Awesome. And so, you know, that we have a long legacy for 30 years or more, really, of community media centers around the country, really sort of championing free speech and public accessibility to media tools, media education. And these days, we're a lot more than Wayne's World. It's not just VR. A lot of the work that we do is really about inspiring and encouraging creativity, encouraging collaboration, inspiring arts, inspiring people to work together. And Al has a couple projects that they have pioneered out in Northampton that are really cool that I'm going to let him say a few words about.
Okay.
Because they're also doing the Northampton Film Festival. And that's pretty inspiring. Here at Big, we run, last spring we had 17 programs for youth. So we ran 10 after school programs. We're teaching everything from documentary filmmaking to citizen journalism to claymation and animation, Minecraft in Northampton, and Scratch classes. So we're a lot more than Wayne's World. And really for us, it's about how do we inspire that creativity through the new tools and how do we educate people. So we really created the Public VR Lab as a way to first educate people on the new tools and then educate ourselves and learn ourselves how we could create content in the new tools and then also how we could really bring it to the community through our community media resources. And so that's really what we're trying to do. And we're so excited that the Frontline folks, that Kenzie and Carla, are here today to speak to you about their process and what through the amazing work that they've done at Frontline. Do you want to say a few words about kind of some of the projects you have in Northampton and the film festival and anything else about the Public VR Lab?
I mean, we dabble in a lot of different projects in Northampton. We do, for instance, a crowdsourced cinema is a fun project we do. We reshoot a feature film every year by crowdsourcing all the scenes. We're doing The Princess Bride this year. Brookline is doing a bunch of that too. We're also crowdsourcing the soundtrack. So we have 16 musicians signed up to recut the soundtrack. because we're having YouTube take down issues with it. So
and we have actors and actresses that actually were in it. Can you raise your hands? Marsha, can you tell us what part you played in the crowdsourced Princess Bride?
I was Inigo Montoya. Yeah. Right. My father.
We see that it's a really good example of the kind of things that we like, because we're sort of throwing out, well, not completely throwing out, but trying to really reinvent what the community media space is and making it relevant. Crowdsourced cinema does, what it does is it like gives people permission to be creative. And that's something like, being a creative is something that not everyone identifies with, especially as you get older as an adult. When you're a little kid, you can play with crayons. Everyone colors with crayons and is an artist. As you grow up, a lot of people lose that identity. So this is a way to give people access to that and success in that, and also to like engage, like build community around that project, because we have 44 teams creating together, right? And so that's like just a very cool experience. That's actually going to premiere at the Northampton Film Festival. And for anyone who has VR content, we're curating an experience section of the Northampton Film Festival where we'll have four simultaneous stations showing content over the course of one full day in an art gallery with a glass window open to downtown Northampton. It should be really interesting and exciting. And there's a lot of interesting things that'll happen. So if you have content, please like reach out to me if you have stuff you'd like to maybe show. We're trying to curate that right now.
You can also let me know too.
Yeah. And let Kathy know as well. We have to do other cool stuff like Minecraft that Kathy alluded to. We're building a scale model of the city of Northampton in Minecraft. It's a partnership with the planning department and the school system and us. And that is VR tourable, so we can fly around our downtown. Our downtown's complete. And the whole city is actually somewhat complete in a sense. We have a 17-year-old kid who is gathering what's called LIDAR data from the city, from topographical flyovers of airplane, low-altitude flyovers, generating topographical maps. And he was waiting at the door for them to deliver this like $20,000 project the city paid for, and he got it first. He got a copy on his USB drive, and that was converted into Minecraft data. So it's a pretty interesting project, and we hope to curate like community discussions about planning and things like that with it too. So we like things that operate at a lot of levels of community, technology, and art. And so VR is one of those, that's sort of how we're seeing it. There's also like an ethics to having a public conversation about VR as it emerges. It's very important. This is a very powerful and intense technology that generates a lot of emotional realities in people. And so we just want to be having that conversation wherever it goes.
It's also a way to give voice. All of these projects that Al is talking about, you know, it's a way to give voice, and it's a way to give people opportunities to create. I mean, I think one of the things with the crowdsourced cinema, we were astonished at how many people wanted to be a part of it. Why aren't those people coming in and creating content with us? Well, maybe they don't have an idea yet. They haven't really thought like of a project that they want to do. So it gives an opportunity for people to be a part of a collaborative project in any of these areas of projects in technology or in media that we're starting to formulate. And we're also very interested, like with media, we do media literacy work at all of our media centers. You know, like in regular media and in now legacy media, right? There's a concern that a lot of that content is being created by corporate funders and that they have a particular interest. And so we help people deconstruct media, and we have curriculum that's talking about, you know, who's the creator of this content and why are they creating it and what audience are they creating it for? And what do they want you to believe when you watch this content? And we think that this is also really important in the VR world and AR world. We want people to ask those kinds of questions. We want to teach people critical thinking. And so this is another medium, and a very new medium, and a medium that, as we're watching your reactions as you're doing VR for the first time, a few of you, but for the last 3 months, we've been doing public demos at our media centers twice a week, so people are coming in and trying it. And so we're seeing, you know, I saw a 80-year-old-ish Rotary member the other day who had the goggles on. He had the little robot dog, some of you might have seen in the lab. And he went to throw a stick, and he ran after it and almost ran into one of the brick walls. And I literally had to like run and get in front of him and block him and say, no, because it was so real to him. He felt so immersed that he didn't know that he was in our lobby in Brookline. He thought he was in Iceland running after a little robot dog. And I think that really speaks to what Al is saying, is that this could be really dangerous. We have to make sure that we're also thinking clearly about what it is that we're creating as content creators and what we're watching as consumers and viewers of content, and that we are consumers. So I think that's some of the conversation that we hope to generate by creating kind of a forum to facilitate this dialogue about public accessibility and consciousness around how we're using these new tools with the Public VR Lab. So we want to invite you to participate. This isn't our thing. You're now part of it. So welcome. You're co-founders with us. So you're here, and we want you to give us ideas about what you'd like to see us create for content for the next event. We'll do the next Public VR Lab meetup in Western Mass. So late September, kind of a good time to come to Western Mass. And we'll have interactive and also a meetup event there and a speaker. And we have kindly, the frontline folks have agreed to give us some new content that they're going to have. So we're really excited about that. You'll be able to come and watch that content. And we have some other kind of big projects that we're working on getting to come to the festival. So that will be the next one. And then we'll do another event here. So we'll rotate back and forth. So we're trying to unify Massachusetts. Because, you know, Western Mass, yeah. Western Mass, you know, is kind of far away for people in Boston. So we wanna bring everybody together. Anything else you wanna add?
Yeah.
Okay, any questions or thoughts or anything anybody wants to say before we get started with Carla and Kenzie? Yes?
So just a quick question. I think 3D was pretty intense when it came to, and it kind of faded away, and there wasn't too much content created. Do you think VR is gonna go the same way, or it's gonna be completely different?
It's a great question. You wanna answer that?
No one has any idea at all.
That's a good answer.
Well, it's true. I mean, I think a lot of people want it to succeed. People in this room have some connection to it, so there's a natural inertia for everyone in this room to think it's gonna succeed.
Yeah.
But we also have to realistically, I think, say that it may not succeed. I think we're in that stage, like everyone's, like that. One of the common stories is that early film experience where there's a train coming at the audience and everyone's getting out of the way. I mean, we're still in that sort of space. We were talking to someone from Discovery VR who was saying, you know, it's like, oh, look at the lion. We're in that kind of like, when you have a VR lion in a space, it's just amazing because it's so, so powerful. That may fade away. You know, there's issues of like how it's going to be distributed. We had a conversation today about that. And so there's too many factors, I think, to make it predictable. But my instinct is, yeah, I think it's going to succeed because it just feels. It feels when I'm in it, like I want to do it. So I think other people are having that feeling too.
And I'll just add to that and say that I think there's what we're also seeing is not just seeing films and seeing immersive journalism. There's also all these other applications. And there's some amazing medical and health-related, behavioral-related research that I think is just really going to be impactive and powerful. I mean, they're testing, and they have already proven that they're getting some response to helping PTSD survive and survivors. You know, by putting people and phobias, putting people back in those environments, actually sort of slowly over time mitigates those memories and experiences for them and diminishes their trauma. I mean, how amazing if we could do things like that with tools like this. I think that's really different from other technologies we've had in the past. I also think there's a tremendous value. The empathy factor, I think, is really valuable. I think there's a lot of work we could do. There's curriculum that we could create even with VR that might be impactive in creating how we experience things and how we interact with each other. And there's also a very social aspect to it that is still kind of, I mean, we're Wild West here. Definitely, but I mean, that is very much, you know, the social aspect I think is going to be more and more proven. As when people stop thinking of it as a game, I think that's one of the reasons I created, some of you came in the theater and my little ghetto demo of the piece, but that is going to be, you know, once people can see it as storytelling, and I think these guys will see it as, you know, will give you a really good view of how it's storytelling and how it's filmmaking, and that I think can be really impactive. You know, we've got Sony PlayStation coming out with their device before Christmas and other devices coming out, and it's getting easier and easier. I mean, even just 6 months ago when we bought the Vives and they weren't coming until May, January, we had no idea, like, well, maybe they won't even be in business by then, I don't know. So there's still a lot of that, but my feeling, and I know I am biased, as I'll mention, but I do feel like there's some amazing technologies that will kind of spring from this even. And I'll let these guys maybe answer that too once they do their talk. And I also just want to say, I want to give a huge round of applause to the big staff, especially Ben Brown, who made the facilities beautiful tonight, along with the other team members. But he can see us because he is actually making this a television show, YouTube show. So we'll be putting it on air on our cable channels in the future, and we'll also put it on online, and I'll share it with the meetup group and also online and also on our web pages for Public VR Lab. And please join the Facebook group. We have a Facebook group for Public VR Lab. Please sign up on the webpage, publicvrlab.org, and so we can stay connected with you and invite you and also get your ideas. So on that note, I really am stepping on into the audience, and you guys, thank you so much for coming, and we're excited to hear from you.
Yeah,
happy to be here.
Yeah, thank you for having us. So, you know, I'm really actually impressed and a little bit shocked that so many of you guys had seen VR before today. So just curious, how many of you, in terms of the VR you were watching, were viewing on a cardboard device? Okay. And how many of you were viewing on like a Samsung Gear headset? Those whites. Oh, that's actually really good. And what about an Oculus or an HTC Vive? All right, we are talking to some seasoned veterans here. Okay. How many of you have made a VR project or a 360 film? Done any work in VR? And an augmented reality. And how many of you played Pokemon Go? Everyone, okay. No. So anyways, I'm Carla. I have been with Frontline for 7 years, working with the editorial team in a bunch of different ways. Currently, I work a lot on digital video, and digital video can be so many different things. One of the new ways, or new mediums for digital video is, of course, VR and 360.
And I'm Kenzie Audette, so I split my time with our VR division and also work with the post-production for our broadcast. So we do an hour-long documentary on Tuesdays most of the year, but, you know, and so a lot of that is just understanding, you know, how do we get this content out to the people and, you know, make it look as beautiful as it can, and what kind of programs and tech can we use to achieve those goals. So ties in well, I think.
Yeah. Let's see. This way? Yeah, there we go. And so in terms of what we want to share with you guys today and sort of get your thoughts on is sort of like the VR process, right? And we're going to tell you a little bit about how we got into this, how it all works, hopefully basically peel back the curtain a little bit, demystify the process, and have you guys walking out of here feeling like you have a better understanding and possibly go out today and make some sort of VR experience. And we'll share some of the secret sauce, lessons learned, mistakes that we've made along the way so you don't have to make them. In terms of Frontline, we've been doing documentary journalism for over 30 years now. So we have, you know, a long history of exploring different forms of storytelling and different ways that we can share our journalism and tell really great stories. And so our executive producer, Rainey Aronson, was actually at an MIT fellowship at the Open Doc Lab back in 2014, and they were exploring all sorts of new technology, of which one was VR. And I think was really excited about the potential for exploring and experimenting and trying to pioneer in this new form. Come what may, as you said, we all don't know what's going to happen with this, but it certainly doesn't hurt to explore new ways that we can tell journalism and share our reporting in really powerful ways. And so the first project we actually did, which I don't know, some of you probably saw in the demos, was Ebola outbreak. You know, it's a starting place. That's all it was. Rough around the edges. We know that. I think one thing, if for any of you guys who saw it, probably noticed, was, you know, there was a lot of 2D footage integrated in it, and that's because we had our most tech-savvy, incredible director, producer, he composes his own music, he shoots his own films, go into the field And in addition to making his documentary, we handed him a 360 camera, and this is back in 2014, mind you, and said, good luck. And good luck staying safe and not getting Ebola. Good luck making a documentary, and good luck making this new form of storytelling. And so there were limitations. There were a lot of technical difficulties in the field. It's all a learning process. And so, again, we just really see this right now as a time to experiment, explore, and push the medium forward. And so at this point, we've done several films, collaborating with a variety of partners and a variety of filmmakers. And to any of you guys who are, you know, early career, this is an incredible avenue. Some of these filmmakers are really quite young and emerging. And the great thing is that it's an even playing field. You know, no one knows what they're doing, and don't pretend to believe them if they say that they know what they're doing. And so it's different than like documentaries, where some of our filmmakers have been doing it for literally 30 years. They make like multiple documentaries every single year. And so it's just, I think, a really cool, exciting place to be today. And so Kenzie is going to help me break down the process for you guys. He's our technical VR guru. And really, to start, you got to ask yourself some really basic questions. And that's, what's your story and why VR? Monoscopic or stereoscopic, and Kenzie will help make sense of that. 360 or kinematic VR? And then where do you plan to publish? Where are you gonna go with this film? And so to start, what's your story, okay? And why are you doing VR? And I think you have to be really honest with yourself. What's your story and why is it going to be better told as an immersive 360 experience? And if you can't really answer that question, if you're thinking, oh, well, could you also do it just as a documentary, then it's probably not going to be the most powerful experience that it could be. And I had an animation, the reason why I have this like weird little Wile E. Coyote cartoon playing in the background here is because I had an animation professor in college who really pushed us on this question of medium, of right form. So, you know, he had one of these days where he set up the classic like fruit bowl to paint, and he said, okay, back in the day, you had these incredible realistic paintings of that, but they didn't have photography. Today you have photography. You could take a video of it. So what does animation offer you that's unique? And I think it's the same thing with VR. There's a lack of frame with VR. There's a sense of presence and being in this space with VR. There's the empathy machine we keep hearing about. So you have to ask yourself, is this going to be better because of those, you know, unique attributes?
Yeah, and I guess, sorry to be the bummer in the group, but you know, what do you want to shoot with, and you know, what kind of camera suits your needs? And I think this is a tough question to answer, because for most of our existence in filming with video, you know, the best is the most expensive, or at least something of that ilk. And it's easy to fall into that trap with VR. However, you know, I think we're at a point right now where it's actually really exciting for young filmmakers to get into the industry, and I'll sort of explain that in more detail later, but I kind of wanted to show you like some options. So our first piece we did was Ebola outbreak with our filmmaker Dan Edge, and we sent him out with a 12 camera GoPro rig setup. It's actually at the bottom there. And you know, it's a very powerful system, but it's, you know, actually limited in some ways and very difficult to use, and can be, you know, an added burden to your process in the field, and maybe not something you want to get into for your first sort of setup. So, you know, this monoscopic versus stereoscopic really just refers to, you know, is it giving a different image to each eye? You know, then hence the 12 cameras. You'll see each side has two cameras on it. That's because it's feeding to each eye. However, lately we've actually been moving back into a more monoscopic sort of experience. Why? Well, mostly just because of quality, actually. You'd think more cameras is better, but, you know, there's a lot of technical issues that come with having a rig that big, something called parallax errors, where you actually have the cameras really far apart, and that leads to a perspective issue. And so how do you fix those perspective issues? Well, you have to sort of do a bunch of technical stuff with the stitching programs, AutoPano and VideoStitch, and then some masking stuff with After Effects. It gets very time-consuming, and you can really, you know, put yourself in a hole technically. And I think that's sort of the lesson for me a lot about this is, how do we make this easier? How do we make this something of a creative medium? And that's sort of what's going to drive the medium forward in a lot of ways. And so, you know, that's a 6-camera GoPro rig. You actually end up with a very high quality image from that. Equal quality to the 12 camera rigs. And then up in the corner you have something that Facebook's sort of unveiling, and that's a, you know, $140,000 camera. So you can go there if you want. I don't think that's really worth it though. So yeah.
And then another question is, again, cinematic versus kinematic. And I think these are all new terms. I think we're all trying to establish, like, what's the best way to describe VR. I think, like, there's a question, too, of, like, 360 VR. Is it the same? Is it different? So we'll just sort of explain the terminology as we're using it right now. So you want to explain cinematic?
I think, you know, cinematic is a lot of what we've been experimenting with. All of our demos in there are all very cinematic experiences. You're in a fixed location with the camera, the action happens around you, and it's more akin to a frameless sort of traditional documentary.
Yeah, think of a fishbowl. It's basically the fishbowl goes over your head, and then the video image gets stretched around that fishbowl that's on your head.
So I think it's a, you know, certainly a step forward in immersion, and definitely something that, you know, tries out new things, but you know, there's always a farther you can go with these sorts of things, and that's where kinematic VR sort of happens. Definitely more early days for this, and something that has room to grow. I think, you know, we're experimenting right now with a little photogrammetry and videogrammetry and, you know, CG sort of spaces. And so basically what kinematic stands for is, you know, imagine that you have this real estate of this carpet, and so you can actually, like, explore the medium of your shot, you know, by walking around certain subjects and exploring underneath things, looking out the window. It gives you a different level of sort of presence in the space. And I think that really adds to that sense of immersion and sort of sense of presence, but, you know, also has an incredible amount of technical challenges, you know.
That's a totally different process that we're not even going to go into today. Yeah. But maybe another time. As Kenzie said, we've got 3 projects in the works exploring this, so we'll have a lot more to share and explain the next time around on that one. And then publishing. And I think, you know, you rightly said distribution, it's a big question mark right now. There's a lot of people, like, fighting in this territory. And then as journalists and as public media, one of our big concerns is accessibility, right? And some of these headsets and some of these places where you publish are incredibly expensive and limiting to who gets to actually explore this kind of content. But for right now, these are a few of the big players in the space. And there's, you know, again, a really exciting opportunity for new filmmakers, because there are some places that allow you to self-publish. So Facebook, YouTube, Viridio, those are really easy entry points for, you know, just getting in there, creating, and publishing. But there's differences to all of them. There's different tech specs, so you just want to be really smart about looking those up before you dive in. So for example, another aspect of, you know, 360 VR filmmaking that we won't really dive into is audio. But audio can be everything. Kenzie loves audio, so, like, you know, he can evangelize better than I can. But having spatial audio, where the audio is literally mapped to where the objects are. So imagine, you know, in your story, there's a cow that enters the scene and moves behind you. It will truly feel like there's a cow moving behind you, which signals you in your narrative to turn around to that point. But places like Facebook, they don't support that kind of spatial audio. So you could have spent a lot of time, money, and effort creating that beautiful thing, not to be able to share it with the world. So
I think it's definitely
that.
Coming, though, for all. Like, this is a strong part of the storytelling for VR, and definitely helps trigger the sort of, you know, interaction and, you know,
cues.
A lot of, yeah. So it's, you still want to direct your subject, and sound is a huge part of that. So.
We'll table that. And so then, here are some of the secret sauce. Basically, it's just mistakes that we've made along the way. So we'll share some of those with you so that you don't have that. And so the very first thing you gotta do is figure out the camera, which Kenzie talked about a little bit.
Yeah, so I'm actually holding the camera that's all the way on the end there. It's just 2 cameras, you know, back to back. It's Kodak SP360. You know, the And so I don't want to get too overwhelmingly boring with you with talk about exports and stuff like that, but you know.
For any of you who do want to geek out, you'll totally do
yeah,
that.
Yeah, I will. I'm happy. Don't worry. I love to.
Gladly geek out.
But the too long didn't read of it basically is that, you know, at the end of the day, if you're putting your video on Facebook or YouTube, all of these cameras right now end up with the same level of quality. They all end up with a 4K image.
That's
and so, yeah, so we're not even talking like the 4K image you might be seeing at Best Buy on those TVs, or if you even have an early adopter. We're talking about the fishbowl example that she used earlier. That is the whole image. So it's been wrapped around your entire head. So the whole image that you have is all 4K, and you're just getting a small portal of that at any given moment. So it ends up being, you know, a lot less quality than that. This is sort of where we're at in the medium, and you know, this has a lot of room to grow, right? You know, we're used to a very high level fidelity with our HD video and all these 4K cameras coming out. So that being said, it's a lot better to be flexible at this stage. This is very much so a learning experience for all of us. We're all learning how to tell stories and use this medium to the best of our abilities. And part of that is staying flexible and making this low cost, low technically savvy, and more about being creative. And the other added element to that is two cameras is a lot less to stitch, right? We're talking a totally different level of technical prowess that comes with a free app that will let you even do that. You know, this is getting the technology out of the hands of just people that are interested in, you know, the ones and zeros and actually want to get this into people that want to create art. And I think that's a big step forward for this medium and something we haven't actually had the luxury of seeing a lot of yet.
So look for some two camera options. This is a Kodak, there's a Samsung 360, and then if you really want to start to get creative, there's some
Black Magic,
more professional cameras that still are a limited amount of cameras, which are gonna save you time in the edit. And so as Kenzie said, more cameras the better. Yes, of course, it's gonna be so much better and prettier, and that's completely wrong, and that's what we learned. This is Dan Edge, our incredible filmmaker and journalist here in West Africa, literally during the outbreak. And he has here one of the 12 camera rigs, as we said, and all it takes is for the batteries to go out of one camera, or to fog over, or it just not to start, because you're clicking play on every single one of those cameras. So unfortunately, that is what happened. And it costs you a lot of money, we learned, on the end, because you gotta basically like go and paint in that whole entire piece frame by frame by frame.
Rotoscoping is
not good. So that is definitely a lesson learned.
Yeah, and so that being said, you know, I mentioned earlier, you know, you want to be, you know, exploring this medium, not afraid of sort of the technology and the costs, right? And some of that is, you know, it's just cheap and easy to use, but also some of that is that it's just cheap and maybe a little bit expendable, and that, you know, some of our more exciting footage has come from taking huge risks. And what do I mean by that? Well, you're looking at a camera sitting on the X and a plane's flying overhead dropping 75-pound bags of rice.
This is in South Sudan, so for any of you guys who saw On the Brink of Famine or saw a little bit of it, that's from this film. And so they're in an incredibly difficult place to get to. At that point, the threat level was actually quite high for journalists. It was August of last year. And so there's no going back to do, you know, another take. And it's certainly very hard to get another camera and rig. But they were smart. They brought two rigs with them on this. And they were not afraid to really try to push the envelope in terms of what you're able to capture, again, because the lack of frame. So this also is a particularly amazing shot because, as Kenzie said, there's 75-pound bags of rice. You don't actually get that experience, even if you're living there, seeing what that's like, because they have to clear this area. Those bags will kill someone if it lands, and it certainly will kill a camera. So they hoped for the best. They can hid behind the tree, as you have to do with all this 360. You got to get out of the shot, but also for safety, they got out of the shot. And it worked. And that doesn't do it justice. I just have to tell you, like, this is the 2D captured version of it. Seeing in the headset is kind of incredible.
So yeah, and we did that move in After Effects, by the way. So there's great tools that already exist that let you do a lot of, you know, promotional work with this kind of stuff. We get that, you know, maybe not everyone's just popping on our headset, going right to Frontline and checking us out. That's fine. I'm a little hurt, but it's okay. But yeah, and that sort of ties into sort of what are the tools we use to make this kind of stuff. Maybe you already have experimented with some of this, but I think the big take home here is you can see a lot of these names and you probably have recognized them if you've ever made a film, or at least, you know, you got Premiere, it's just, you know, an editing software. Resolve is just a color correction software. You know, these are tools we use for our broadcast film. It's nothing crazy different. You know, mixing in Pro Tools, and you know, that's all very similar. So the one at the top is obviously a little different. This is where we start talking about some more of the craft and sort of artistic decision and sort of the technical side of things, where you get to think about what goes in your shot and how do you stitch it and what are the, you know, parts that can work and how do you, like, you know, work this magic. And that's definitely still an art form. So we've been using AutoPano for all of our videos, but there's other players out there. I think VideoStitch is just as comparable. They're very similar. You know, AutoPano is a partnership with GoPro, which makes it sort of, you know, a lot of great compatibility with our GoPro camera rigs, but nothing too impressive there. So yeah, I think I just want to talk about how this is a little bit different than maybe your regular footage, and you know, it's not something you don't do for your regular film, but we're just seeing one camera's footage, and that's a lot of different clips that you have to find six different other cameras that sync up with them, and it starts to become very complicated. And so I just can't stress enough how much this is like such a big deal, and you know, you really should even be more organized than this, although this is one of our first films. And so we've color corrected each, or colored each of the you know, clips, and I just wanted to draw your attention to how much this can get really, really crazy. So here's another camera. It's all the same.
I mean, again, there's a lot, so a lot more drives. Like, you gotta be ready to go.
Yes, and each of these cameras shoots, you know, very high quality image. We don't use all of it, but it's a good idea to capture at very high quality. We're talking about forward facing. You know, if these platforms that we talk about can take bigger files, you should be ready to be able to update your file and make it look higher quality, because you don't want to have this all this hard work and that those bags of rice that fell from the sky, that shot will be worthless in 5 years if we can't up-res the quality as the technology improves. So, you know, you're looking at one shot, right? So here are all your six cameras, and I just want to sort of give you the basics of what happens when you're stitching. You know, it's, and there they are. So basically you can see how the top one is a camera, right? It's very warped up there, and the bottom one is too. And you know, how do we get to this point? Well, you sync it with audio. You know, we're talking about just having a clap at the beginning of your video, and it's very similar. This is not impossible technology.
I think, or the flash. You want to mention that? That's a little lesson learned that might be easier too.
Yeah. So you know, it's even more accurate if you use a flash from a, just like a camera, or like even your phone. You know, if you turn on the flashlight on the back, great way to go with it. It's even more accurate. So I just, the art form, I think, comes in. If you initially just see like this guy's head right up here, not so much there, and I think you know, that's difficult. You look like you lost your shot, or you just feel more uncomfortable about it. But if you just like hop over to the next slide, it's actually there. It's just in that camera. And so this is where the sort of technique and sort of practice and just sort of meticulousness comes through from your footage. You're actually going through and making a lot of decisions about what cameras are capturing what parts of the piece, and you're doing a lot of, you know, slow watching of your footage, and this can be time consuming. So this is still very much so a factor, and I might mention doesn't have as much of an impact on something like this, where you have two cameras, one seam just goes around the whole thing.
And to that point of artistry, it's also on the directing end. You've got to do a lot of thought in terms of how you're going to compose your shots, given all the different cameras, because that can make all the difference in the edit. So obviously we can't direct the cow, okay? So you're stuck a little bit there, but you can see that seam, right? Going right through the head, right through that. That causes way more problems on the back end. And so you really want to think about, you know, where's your subject? What's the action? How can I center that in the camera and make sure that the least movement's happening in the seams between all of those cameras? Because you're gonna end up with much better results. And again, with this camera, you only have one seam, so that makes it a little bit easier. But it's something as a director and an artist, you really actually have to think about on the front end.
Yeah, and so that cow was a huge pain in the butt. He just, you know, would move. And, you know, and you could say he was actually between three different cameras. So there was a lot of work to going on to this cow. And I won't go into all of this, like, pain the neck stuff that we did. But one of the other things I sort of mentioned earlier was, you know, you're not going to be able to get everything perfect with the stitching software. There are going to be some artifacts and some issues. And so what we had to do for this guy is we took a little bit of his horn from one camera, and we sort of covered over like where we could, and then we switched at certain times, like had sort of like a morph on it. And then right there is just like a little mask of the sky, because there was just a little artifact and we couldn't quite get rid of in the auto pano pro. So, you know, definitely still an instance where the technology is, you know, part of the process. And you know, there's some things it's easy to shot block, can't really direct the cow to quite get out of the way, so I think that's, you know, it's part of working with the medium.
But yeah, and it's gonna get better. It is getting better every day. Like, it is so much easier than when we started back in 2014 already. People are pouring a ton of money into the technology, the software, the hardware. So with time, it will become a lot easier. Like, I don't know if there's any sort of documentary filmmakers, but like back in the day, you would cut the tape, right? And like that was time consuming and tedious, and now you don't have to do any of that. So we'll get there.
So we position the cameraman in this? I mean, is he kind of
That's a great, great question. It is critical. So if you are not part of the story yourself as the filmmaker, there's a couple of things that you can do. One is simply get out of the shot. Literally, like, hide somewhere. And you can see sometimes, like, for example, with the food drop, there's a tree that could go behind it. I've heard of other filmmakers where they were on a beach, and so it's very hard to get out of the way. They found a dune, and they had a crew that was, I think, 20 people. This was a commercial project. They literally had everyone in the crew line up. They checked the one angle in which you couldn't see them if they all lined up in one line behind the dune. Another thing that you can do is do a mask. So basically, you can basically, I've had a filmmaker who, you've got the monopod, right, with the camera, and he went below and actually like wrapped his legs around the monopod, so he was underneath it, and then you take a plate shot. So after you do that, make sure you have it marked where the monopod is, and you take a picture. So if that's grass, you can just mask him out with the grass.
Might be tough if it's a windy day, but you know, other than that,
yeah,
you're, you know, these are just sort of techniques to hide. I did a recently just did a shoot in a very crowded antiques roadshow sort of setup where they're doing like the demos of all of their things, and you know, you can hide in the crowd or whatnot. The trick becomes, how do you tell everyone around you that there's a film going on or that they can't, you know, go in certain places? So we were doing stuff like masking the ground with just masking tape or gaffer's tape, you know, trying to have like crew there that were just sort of already there working on their other sort of shoots, just, you know, keep an eye on things. Even still, you know, you're talking about walking away from your camera, you have very little control. And, you know, one of the shots, somebody kicked the tripod by accident, and so I had to, like, you know, but lose that shot. But so it's, you know,
it's a learning process, but I think it's exciting. And it's just, again, a time to pioneer. And so then after that stitching, it goes into editing, just like you would edit a regular film. So it goes into Premiere. And
yeah, and that's, I think, a huge take home for this is that, like, a lot of the skill set that, you know, filmmakers already have is totally viable here. You know, we're doing a lot of our graphics-based text work in After Effects. We're doing, you know, some of the sort of, you know, in our promo, if you, any of you guys got to see that, some of the world building and the sort of fake spaces that we were putting you in, just in After Effects using a program, you know, called Metal. And this is, you know, these are tools and skill sets and hotkeys that just exist already. And, you know, we're working with 4K just files, so they already work fine in Premiere. None of this stuff is that out of the ordinary. And I think that's good for the medium, just, you know, reiterate that, like, how do we make it not expensive, how do we make it not like difficult, and so that we can get young creative people into the space. And I think that's really exciting for, you know, people like me, but it seems like a lot of people like you who have, you know, some basic understanding of these sort of programs and want to tell stories and don't want to have like to learn any of these new, you know, tools just to have them change in a couple of years. It's like today's tools for sort of a tomorrow's sort of product, and I think that's great.
Yeah, so I think like for us, like the big takeaways for anyone who wants to dive into this brave new world with us, monoscopic, right now you're not getting a lot of extra added 3D effect with the stereoscopic. So monoscopic, maybe a two camera option, so you only have one seam to stitch, at least when you're starting out.
Yeah, I mean, we didn't really talk about this at all, but it's something so easily forgotten, and I've made this mistake so many times with that shoot I just did in Antiques, where the height of the camera is really important. Like, who are you subjecting? Are you having them sitting in a chair with another person sitting in a chair? Is it like in the middle of a field where your subject is, you know, 6 feet tall? Maybe you want to be the same height as them. Putting on the headset and having the camera been shot from a really low angle makes you feel so small and can feel really strange if you're, you know, a regular size.
But the cool
adult.
Thing is you can use that to your advantage too for
yes.
storytelling. So there's some creativity involved with that, in that you don't necessarily have, you know, when you're contained in that frame, but the perspective of having someone literally towering over you or you towering over someone could be a device that you're using in your storytelling.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So, and then just, this is sort of a little more amorphous, not necessarily as concrete, but one of the things we've been doing a lot of is, you know, changes. There's always going to be a lot of changes.
We're frontline. It's never
yes,
done.
At the last minute, you know, yeah, we're, sorry. We're, exactly. I mean, I work in post-production, so we're even supposed to be done with the film at that point. We're not done. We're still changing the script and re-recording dialogue and all this kind of stuff. That happens in VR as well. And one of the things that can be a really time-consuming, pain-in-the-butt part of this process is the first step, stitching. So it makes a lot more sense to just give yourself a rough stitch so that the editor can start working with the content, and then at the end, only stitching meticulously the footage that you want to use. I know my workflow was, you know, stitching first, then editing or whatever, you know, but like, you're really gonna end up stitching again at the end. Like, it's just gonna happen. You're gonna notice something in the edit. You're gonna notice something when you put the goggles on. You know, this is a totally different experience where the editor doesn't quite know what he's working with, especially if he's working in Premiere. You're working with an unwrapped file, so it's very warped. It was very similar to the images I was showing from the, you know, the stitching process, but like, you're not entirely sure what you're looking at or where the mistakes are. And it's really important to go through this footage. Yeah.
Can the stitching and the editing somehow be independent? Because you said like if you spend some time doing a rough stitching and then you edit and then you stitch again, can you all the work that you did in the editing can still be used, or do you have to redo the editing if
yeah.
you stitch again?
So I think that just comes down to like time code, right? So all of the cameras are running time code, and you know you're doing this rough stitch really just to give your editor a sense of the space. And I don't think it's necessarily to go through and meticulously make it look beautiful. It's really just, but you do have to do some of that, right? Because you have six camera streams. So in order to give the editor something that he can work with, a single video file, you need to at least attach them in some rough fashion. Thankfully, you know, if you're using something like AutoPano and a GoPro camera rig, there's already a plugin that says, oh, I understand what rig you're using. I've heard of this one before. I kind of know where they roughly should be, and I will, you know, attach them as best I can. It's never great, but it will get you somewhere.
So you're not losing the work, but one other caveat to that is, so you stitch something and it sort of fits together, and then you can see it in your film, right? This is this scene, scene two, and you're like, okay, I get that. That makes sense in terms of the narrative arc that we're going after, so we're going to use that. And so you thought, like, you spent this time stitching over here to get the tree lined up so it's nice and even, and you're like, okay, that's good. And then what happens is when you go back in to stitch it, and you're like, you know what, yeah, the tree's lined up, but you know what, this person's shoulder is cut off, and actually they're the character, and that's really important. And so you go and pull the character back together, and you've messed up the tree again. So that's where the artistry comes in, and it's literally a game of whack-a-mole to get it right. And you're going to have to also just, like, not be right now where the technology's at, too precious about it. Figure out where are people most likely to be looking? Where is the main activity in your story? And really focus on stitching that perfectly and worry a little bit less about what's happening in
those tweaks, are you just adjusting parameters
in an inspector environment?
Sliders? I mean, you know, I think the technology sort of changed a lot since it first started, and you know, there is a lot of drag and drop now features in the auto pano tools. Uh-huh. So you're, you know, there's you can do it both ways. But yeah, I think essentially she was just talking about, you know, the plates. You know, you can pull the video files around or just like expand them because they actually have overlap. But you know, you don't always know what you're doing in that space until you know see it in a headset. Yeah.
I have a hard time wrapping my mind around how the heck you edit this. Like, how do you decide which part of your VR you're going to cut from to?
Yeah,
you're not alone.
That's, I think, something not we're alone. All struggling with because it's a new medium and there's new pacing involved. And, you know, do you do dissolves? At first we're like, yeah, dissolves seem really smooth, right? But it's like, we don't do a lot of dissolves in our long-form broadcasts. You know, we prefer not to. And, you know, how do you, you know, get used to that sort of jumping around? Or, like, how long do you stay in a scene? Because the person could have not finished. You know, they might want to see more.
Mm-hmm.
These are all questions we're still grappling with. But, you know, the editor still gets to see a pretty good understanding of your shot, especially if your subject is in the front, like, of the image and not sort of, like, cut off on the sides. I don't know if you wanted to just like hop back a couple.
Yeah, absolutely.
So see like this cow over here, and this is the same as this cow, right? So that's not necessarily very easy for like an editor to sort of be like studying to see if, oh, right now the sort of, it's gotten boring, let's cut to the next shot. Like, but you know, it's a lot easier to say if this guy is our subject or even, you know, this boy in the corner here that we're working on, because he's fully in the shot. The editor can still see that. He can make, you know, aesthetic decisions based off that information, and it's still pretty visible.
And something is actually going to be kind of interesting, also kind of a little bit intimidating as like an artist and a director, is that Facebook is actually building a tool right now. This is one of the things they shared at a conference I was at just a couple of weeks ago, that actually has a heat map of every shot in the film. So you'll actually see, once you upload something to Facebook, if you've got a 360 film and you upload it, you'll actually see where the majority of the people were watching and start to see, like, did you do a good job directing and with your storytelling to guide a person along through the experience? Because you might find out that, like, everyone was turned around back there and looking at the cow and they did not see what happened in front of them. So.
Yeah, I think that's really important. So the 360 sort of direction to get people around the space. And, you know, one of the things we haven't really talked about, but it's also just important, is, you know, just because you have all this real estate doesn't mean you always need to use it. And I think one of the things we've kind of been playing with is, you know, it's great to have the person go through this moment where they're spinning around in circles like 100 times, but that gets fatiguing, and you don't want to, you know, manipulate
Whiplash.
Your audience that heavily. It's great to use those moments to sort of illustrate the space, but they should be sparingly, much like sort of like, you know, gimmicks in any sort of medium or jump scares get really old really fast, you know? Like, these are tools that add to the experience of getting you scared or getting you into this moment and immersed, but they shouldn't be abused. And I think, you know, there's just a true realization about just sort of like how we consume content that is very lazy, you know? And I think that's okay, that's good, and that should be sort of used to your advantage. You know, your person is just absorbing the content, you know, they have a bigger field of view and that's great, but that doesn't mean you need to use full 360. You know, maybe 180 degrees is good, giving them some level of control, but not necessarily like whipping them around in circles. So that's something we've been working on too.
I have a question for you, Kenzie.
Yeah.
So when you're setting up your rig, is there a way to have a monitor that's showing you where the stitches potentially will be in the future? You know, I mean, how are you lining up? Like, you were giving that example of them being able to create this line. Are you able to see in a monitor what that's actually going to look like when it renders in 360?
Yeah, it depends on the rig you're using, I think. But, you know, in essence, it's very easy for something like this where I'm like, all right, you're over there and you're over there. Okay,
like with
great.
The GoPro.
Yeah, so one of our, you know, filmmakers, Evan, you know, has this 6-camera GoPro rig and wants to make sure everything's, like, coming out great and, like, you know, he has a lot of stitches to worry about, right? So, you know, his sort of technique was to sort of stream each stream to an iPad or something like that in the field, or even to his computer at sometimes if he felt really nervous about making sure this shot looked perfect. Mm-hmm. He would, you know,
he'd actually bring edit it in the field in, sometimes.
Do some quick stitches on his computer and just sort of preview it at like, you know, a tenth of the
but
resolution.
Tech's getting better. There's certain cameras that's, and we haven't tried them out, but swear that it's like it'll like live stream to a headset and you'll just be able to see it in the field. So
a
I think we'll get
NAB
to
stuff,
that place
yeah.
soon.
So yeah, we saw a lot of that more at NAB this year, the tech conference.
Yeah.
This is not going away. I think it's just very young, and I think it, you know, it's easy to say, oh, you know, maybe it'll never be there. And I think that's, you know, possible. It'll never be quite at the level we all want it to be. But I think that's why it's a great time to be jumping into this medium. As you said, we're partnering with, you know, young filmmakers who are, you know, very skilled. But, you know, this isn't like a, like, this isn't something that anyone has any experience with. You know, everyone's learned it in the last couple of years. You know, people are trying these techniques out, you know, and discovering things that we don't know. You know, I don't think anyone's not at a, you know.
Yeah. And as Kathy said earlier, actually, about how there's all these different applications for VR in a way that it wasn't for, like, you know, 3D TVs or movies. Actually, if anyone's curious about that, how it's being used here, like PTSD or in some of these medical capacities, or even how it's being researched in terms of the ethical questions about, again, having, like, false memories with children who are confused by being in one of these experiences. MIT actually did a conference a couple of months ago called Virtually There, where they had some incredible speakers from across the industry give talks, and it's online, actually. They posted the whole entire thing on YouTube. So if you just look for MIT Virtually There, it's an incredible resource.
I've always been a big fan of the show, and I think one of the best things is the interviews. Those moments where the interviewer is, you know, interrogating the subject, and you see him kind of start to sweat and squirm, you know they've done something wrong.
Oh, you like Martin Smith,
and huh? Being the fly on the wall in that room would be really interesting. But ultimately, it's not the most interesting use of the technology. It's not great VR to just have two people sitting in a room talking to one another.
Or maybe it is. I'm actually going to... if you think about it this way, right? When you're doing a film, you only see the reaction shot that we gave you, right? You're only getting what we cut to. But with VR, if you actually had it in between the two people, you would have the ability to look over at that other person's face throughout that whole time whenever you wanted to see how they're moving, how they're like possibly fidgeting, and just sort of see the true interaction between two. So I think there's something even journalistically about this in terms of transparency with journalism that's kind of remarkable, or even with documentary, right? The fly on the wall kind of feeling, as you said. So imagine there's some really intimate conversations that happen, and when you put a person there and you've got the cameraman like literally in your face like this, you know, how intimate is it really gonna be? We did a film called Being Mortal, and I was in the field on that, and it's this incredible film about the very difficult conversations at end of life between doctors and patients and the struggles, and how actually that can inform, if you just understand that, you could have maybe a better experience, you know, when you're there or when a loved one is going through that. And we had the cameras, and it was very difficult, and it's hard, and trying to figure out, like, you know, when we need to be out of the room. Some of these cameras are so small that you might be able to capture in a much more sort of honest verite way, in some ways.
What it's kind of interesting, though, from a documentary perspective, that's really cool. You can look anywhere you want to, anytime you want to. From a narrative perspective, it creates a tension because you don't know what's behind you. You don't know what you're missing.
I think
have this. You're like, oh my God, I'm missing something. I don't know where to look. So
and
it's
that's
this interesting tension.
Pause then has a big meaning. And reverse and going back.
Well, it's
if
it's
you
also
stop and hear the conversation from one side, now I'll hear it from the other side. We're going to watch the same conversation with Charlie Rose looking at him and saying,
yeah.
What is he saying?
Well, you know, there's still a lot of room to grow there, right? So one of the things that's like we talk about a lot is this concept of stage direction. You know, this is actually in a lot of ways similar to directing a play. You know, how do you cue to stage left? You know, like. Right now, we have to do a lot of that because the audio level isn't there. You know, 360 audio will add a lot to that, you know, and creating a sense of confidence that you're looking the right way. also ties into what I said earlier about, you know, maybe it's not necessary that I look this way almost ever, except for in a couple of key moments. Maybe it's better if I give you a sense of trust and I give you a sense that you're actually looking the right direction and that there's, you know, the good stuff's over here and that this is where the action is, and create even more of a sense that this part is plain and this part has, you know, momentum.
And for journalism in particular, it's very, very challenging because, again, we're not going to be directing, you know, refugees, go this way, go that way. And so for really, like, verite experiences, it's challenging. Or the interview question, right? If you don't want that person there, but you're trying to do the interview, it is incredibly challenging when you have to ask the question and go all the way to the other side of the room to hide, right? Because perhaps you don't actually want to be in the story. So a lot of hurdles that we are really just trying to experiment and explore.
I get a sense also it changes the role of the director because with the conventional cinematography, the director is using that cinematography to tell the story, to make you feel certain things. Maybe Kubrick's use of symmetry, or I don't know if anyone's a fan of Mr. Robot.
Oh, love it.
And they break all the rules of thirds. They'll put the person talking, that's deliberate to make you feel isolated and uncomfortable and off balance. And with this technology now, the director is going to have to figure out new ways to create these feelings because you're able to look anywhere you want. You can't force the viewer to look. You're going to have to use other tricks, and it's a whole industry and science you're going to have to develop yourselves now in order to direct people in that way.
I think that's what's exciting about it in the same way, though, too, is that, you know, this isn't something anyone has mastered, and that there's not people that seem to just have a wealth of experience in commanding
your... There isn't a Kubrick for VR yet.
But, you know, it's maybe something like having the camera be at a certain height is sort of difference, like whether you feel like you're the one that's sort of like commanding the situation, or that you feel so small and defenseless and scared in a situation. You know, there's different techniques like that out there.
You're inviting the your viewers to play a bit of a directorial role.
And that's where you want to stage direct that.
Yep.
That's sort of what I was going to ask, but just to follow that, is there any ability now to catch the person, the viewer, and have that interaction affect what's happening in the...
Yeah, there are a couple of experiences like that. I mean, we did something, we haven't really done too much on that, but there's some things I've seen, like Gone on the Samsung Gear, where your choices direct which cuts come next, you know, and if you want to go over here to explore what's happening underneath the playground, is this kid still there? Oh, just her backpack. You wouldn't know that unless you decided to go there, and so there's a certain level of, you know, choice there, and I think that's really pretty awesome.
Really incredible. It's not out yet, so you have to see it, unfortunately, at like festivals and things, but the Enemy Project, which is a really like transformative experience if you go through it, where they talk to basically two mortal enemies, someone in Palestine and someone in Israel, who are fighters, and the device that they use allows you to, again, it's walk around VR, so you can walk around the person, and as you get close to the person will back off because you've gotten into their personal space, and they're building it such that they'll have multiple people within that experience with you, so it's a much more embodied experience. So yeah,
so I read a little bit, and what I see is a lot of talk about not enough immersion in the VR experience. Do you think there's such a thing as too much immersion in the VR experience?
Yeah
absolutely, 100%. And I think with something
that's a director's tool.
I think as journalists, personally, we have to be very careful about that. And so one of the things that we're tasked with as part of a grant that we got with the Knight Foundation is to explore sort of best practices and ethical standards for journalism. You know, you could put a camera in a war zone. Should you put a camera in a war zone that allows someone full visibility of absolutely everything, you know? Even with...
Not on PTSD.
I know.
Exactly.
You know, and people could argue the same thing in sort of refugee situations and what you're doing. And with children especially, as I mentioned, the research earlier that is being done, where like differentiating between reality and real life in these experiences, even though the fidelity is not great, is particularly tricky for children.
There's an aspect of VR that makes me think of IMAX. And I was wondering, do you know if there's any content that has been shown on IMAX theaters?
That I really... So you mean just like, almost like the whole room is the bubble and you can look in all directions? I mean,
like a planetarium, you know?
Not that I've seen, but I think it's perfectly possible.
There's, yeah.
think there's one that they showed at Tribeca that was about the atom bomb this year that was in a room that they built with multiple screens all around the audience. And they had a live orchestra playing in the center of it.
Wow. Oh, boy.
Wow.
That's
really cool.
Yeah. Do you have any, like, are we at a point where there are actually, like, workshops for journalists who want to learn more about VR, like young filmmakers who want to learn more about VR.
Yeah, and there's actually some great resources too. So Evan Wexler, who was one of the three filmmakers who did our South Sudan film, actually, as part of the experience, created these YouTube videos online that's just about stitching that you can check out. We'll also, as part of our night grant, put out a sort of 101 toolkit.
Okay.
And I can actually send you, there's a couple of links of these great guidebooks that sort of go through the whole entire process. It's more towards VR in general as opposed to, you know, journalism. We'll have that guide out.
But yeah, I mean, on that note, I think sort of are the questions about how to tell a good story or how to do, you know, the right journalistic stuff really hasn't been discovered fully yet. And that's why, you know, it just takes trial and error. And, you know, we're going through that right now. I would love to say we have, you know, answers, but, you know, this is just an evolution. And, you know, and that's where we're at with this medium right now. I don't think anyone expects it to be done by the end of the year or anything. It's just, it's constantly growing. You know, there's tons of resources for the tech and understanding how to make these things. But, you know, I haven't seen enough good content out there to convince me that any one person knows the right answers for telling a good story in this space.
Time will tell.
So I'm going to jump back up because I think we're getting about to the end of an hour. I haven't gotten the word from the staff because they're all enthralled. I'm sure
they've got the headsets on.
Yeah, the staff is all in there watching. So, are there any other questions that folks have? We have time for maybe one more.
Well, it's not really a question; it's more a comment. But I was just thinking, this sort of reminds me of the beginning of films versus theater, where people hadn't discovered you could move the camera yet. It's all still and looking.
Or silent films versus,
yeah, exactly.
You know, starting to bring in audio.
Yeah.
I think, and that's why it feels different for me than like 3D or something like smartwatches, where it's, you know, these things are cool and they're great and they add some level of sort of like wow factor, but they're not drastically different enough to change how you would tell a story or how you would work with the medium, or that certain things worked in this space that didn't seem to work in traditional mediums. And, you know, and that's why for me it seems like it's just young. It's not necessarily not worth it, but, you know, time is really the only answer to that.
I will also mention to you that we're, as part of the Public VR Lab, we'd love any links that you guys can send to us, but if other folks have ideas and links and things that they want to share, we can post that all on the publicvrlab.com webpage, and we can also post it in Facebook and also on Brookline Interactive and NCTU's pages as well, so that everybody can have access to that. We're going to teach 360 classes this fall. So we've already got that on our schedule. We're also teaching audio, and our audio teacher is really interested in binaural audio and trying to figure out kind of the best solutions. And our staff are also kind of brainstorming different ways that we want to do interactive piece this year. We've actually given out a grant. Both NCTV and us have we have a community production grants that we give out. So we're using some of our community media funding to be able to fund filmmakers. Daniel, Lisa Sam, he was one of our grantees last year. And so we have our second round of grantees, and one of them is interactive. We're going to be making that decision the next week. And then next year, we're going to do that again. And so we're very interested in creating interactive content that's really community-focused. These guys are doing the international stuff. We definitely aren't doing that, but we want to do it on the local basis, and we have lots of ideas, and we welcome yours. And come be a part of us learning. As they said, they're still learning. So it's a great time to explore and try to learn things. I know for me, I didn't know how to edit in 360 until this week. And I just sat down for a couple of hours and figured it out. And so we have tools that you can come in to our media centers and try, and we'll also learn with you. So we're excited to do that. I want to really thank Kenzie and Carla so much.